Vercel Functions now start up faster and have fewer cold starts. And in this video, I want to walk through two recent blog posts we published that go behind the scenes on how we made some of these changes. So let's get into it. The first change, which is the most obvious, is that we now keep a minimum of one active instance of your function running for paid plans on production environments. So if your site doesn't get a ton of traffic, this can help a lot to keep at least one function active all the time. The second and third changes here are actually two out of the three parts of what makes up a cold start. So you have your infrastructure, you have the runtime code, so Next.js or other frameworks, and then you also have your code. I recently talked about this in our Vercel Ship keynote, which is where I'm stealing this video from. But today, in this video, we're going to talk more about the infrastructure changes that we made, as well as your code changes and how we're able to speed that up. So the first one is on the infrastructure side. So Vercel Functions are now powered by Rust. I'm going to walk through this post. We're going to talk about it a little bit, and then we'll get into the second one, which is bytecode caching. So Vercel Functions, they run code on demand without the need to manage your own infrastructure, provision servers, or upgrade hardware. And now under the hood, this is now powered by Rust, which is a lower level language. We're gradually rolling out these improvements to all new deployments. So if you're watching this video now, you're probably already using our Rust-powered functions. No action is required. We've already served billions of invocations on our new system, and it's faster and a slightly lower cost too. So love passing on some of those cost savings. So we've seen about 30% faster cold starts for smaller workloads, and then for larger workloads, about 80 milliseconds faster or 500 milliseconds faster in that, you know, P99 most extreme case. So why did we make this change? Well, why Rust? If you've watched content from Vercel before, you know that we're kind of Rust-pilled. We really like Rust, and we've put a bunch of content out around moving to Rust for things like Turbo Pack and Turbo Repo and the Next.js compiler at large. So this might not be something new, but I think it's still helpful to talk through. So we've been adding features to Vercel Functions over the years that required extending our base infrastructure primitives. So it was more than what we got out of the box with the underlying cloud infrastructure tools. So the ability to be able to stream responses before it was available natively, to have these web API-based signatures, so the web request and response format, automatic recursion protection, so that if your function is doing something which it probably shouldn't be doing, we can prevent having that runaway spend, and a lot more. And as we've profiled and improved and iterated on function performance, we saw a lot of opportunities to continue improving startup times. The first was rewriting the function initialization phase, so when it actually starts up, and the invocation phase, so when you actually call the function, to use a lower level language than JavaScript. So we have this helpful diagram here showing what we had before, where the user code and the Vercel system bridge, this was all running with Node.js, but now we have this Rust powered core. So you're still writing your code in a language like Node.js, like JavaScript, and our Rust powered core is going to take that and help speed things up for you. So about 80 milliseconds faster on average. While moving to Rust is not a silver bullet, which is very true, it can greatly improve performance and memory management for certain workloads. And I mean, we could also talk more about the specific algorithms or data structures you use as well, but we can talk about that later. After some early experiments, it was clear moving to Rust could produce significant performance wins. The following parts of our function bridge are now optimized in Rust. So how we read and attach environment variables, which was actually a TIL. Today I learned for me that that could impact the startup time, is just reading one environment variable in your function. Actually spawning the Node.js process, streaming and encrypting the chunked responses from your stream, and using APIs like wait until before completing the function invocation. If you haven't seen wait until, go check that out. It allows you to kind of do some work after you've already returned a response back to the visitor. So how much faster are Vercel Functions? Well, we first kind of tested this in the lab with a synthetic benchmark that was just Hello World running in US East. And we had enough time for it actually to go cold, so about 15 minutes. This was also before we had the automatic warming for paid plans. So they're about 150 milliseconds faster on average in comparison to our previous version. But again, this is a lab test, synthetic test. We wanted to actually test and make sure this worked with production traffic. So we started to roll this out on our own projects internally, but then also validate it with a subset of traffic. These functions go through two phases, the initialization and invocation. So we saw up to 80 milliseconds faster for average case and 500 milliseconds faster for the larger cases. Now, when streaming, functions connect to the nearest Vercel edge region somewhere in the world. And now that that part is also powered by Rust, this process was 47% faster and 77% faster for the time to connect. So, not bad. This means that the duration that you get billed for is also slightly shorter. So you'll pay slightly less for the same workloads since it's faster. And it means that frameworks that default to streaming, like ConnectJS App Router, will also be faster. And you know, there's other frameworks that do that as well, or if you're using standalone Vercel functions. We've also slightly tweaked some of the bits of our regional routing just to keep making things fast. By the way, you can also tweak your CPU and memory options for your function in the dashboard. So if you haven't done that and you want to dial that up or dial that down, I'd recommend at least being on the standard option. Okay, what's next? Well, this was the first in the series. So this was before we had our Vercel ship event and we released the next set of the series. So we can jump from this post over to bytecode caching. So the first one was about our infrastructure. Bytecode caching is about your code. We want to speed up the code that you provide into a Vercel function. So let's talk through this one. We recently shipped a Rust-based core to Vercel functions to improve startup times, but now we're launching a new experimental feature to further reduce startup times for larger applications up to 27% faster cold starts. So we're calling this bytecode caching. One of the slowest parts of a cold start is actually loading and compiling the JavaScript source code. Before executing the code, it needs to be parsed and compiled into bytecode, which is then directly executed on the V8 virtual machine or compiled into machine code by V8's just-in-time compiler or JIT compiler. So we have a little visualization here. You bring your JavaScript code written in some function. Here it's in our isomorphic web handler syntax, which just means that you write it with the web request and response APIs. That gets turned into bytecode and then eventually turned into machine code. This conversion to bytecode must happen when the JavaScript file is executed for the first time. So you make a request, or more accurately, a visitor makes a request to your site, and that's when that actual compilation of the bytecode happens. Well, what if we could cache this step and reuse it later on subsequent cold starts? Well, that's exactly what we did. So a visitor comes in, invokes a function, it compiles the bytecode. That was before, right? But now the first execution will produce a bytecode cache, and successive executions and cold starts will reuse and optimize the cache. This can improve the cold start duration by transparently eliminating the compilation step. So now, you know, one of those steps was just cut out. It comes back, someone invokes a function, and it can just read the bytecode directly. Not bad. So what are the results? We initially tested this with three different XJS applications of different sizes. So each one gets a cold start after about 15 minutes. And then we compared the duration before and after bytecode caching. So the first one was about 250 kilobytes, and the time to first byte went from 873 milliseconds to 764 milliseconds, so about 12% faster. And then the duration that you're actually billed also went down about 58%, and so on and so forth for larger sizes. So the second application was about twice as big, and then the third application was coming in at about 800 kilobytes. And you can see consistently, the time to first byte gets better as the larger amount of user code is provided and then cached into bytecode. And, you know, the build duration's about, let's call it 50% for all of them. Build duration decrease. With bytecode caching, your function will both start faster and have a lower build duration. Nice. Okay, technical details. So the V8 compile cache NPM package is a widely known package in the ecosystem, but it can't easily be used in a serverless platform. The file system is ephemeral and fresh during a cold start. So we developed our own bytecode caching implementation that overcomes this limitation and allows all subsequent cold starts to use the produced bytecode cache. The system can continuously improve the cache as more traffic is sent to the function. So for example, assume you have two routes. You have your home route and you have your blog route. Your framework like a Next.js or a SvelteKit, Your framework lazy loads these routes from two different JavaScript chunks. A user visits home for the first time. The bytecode generated for this first chunk is cached and then reused for future cold starts. But when a user hits /blog, it produces a separate bytecode cache. So this chunk wasn't lazy loaded. Vercel Functions and the underlying infrastructure now can intelligently merge together all bytecode chunks, regardless of when or where they're created. So this helps you get faster cold starts as your application gets more traffic. It's like the map in video games where you have to go explore and find more of the map and it unlocks it. With this, it's like, I'm going to go visit the homepage. That caches one bit of the bytecode. That'll go visit the blog page. That caches another bit of the bytecode. So pretty helpful. So if you want to try out bytecode caching, we've been using it, dogfooding on some of our external stuff. Just to reiterate, this is experimental still, so we would love to hear your feedback as you try it out. You'll need Node 20, and you'll need a framework that compiles to CommonJS, which is what Next.js does by default. In Node.js 22, there's actually a new option to support ESM here, which is great. Thank you, Node.js team. But if you want to try this out, you can add the environment variable use_bytecode_caching=1. You can just copy that and paste it into the environment variables page. It will automatically format it for you. And this only applies to production deployments. So if you want to try it out, add that environment variable, redeploy your application, and then let us know. So that was a whirlwind of changes and updates that we've been making for Vercel Functions to make them faster. We have a Rust-powered core. We have new experimental bytecode caching. We keep a minimum of one active instance warm for production traffic. All in service of helping your application start up as fast as possible, whether you have no users, no traffic, or a decent chunk of traffic. If you try this out and have good results, let us know. I'd love to hear how your usage of Vercel Functions is going. And if you want to see us create more content on Vercel Functions, let me know. Peace.